How are you?
Good, good.
Good. Why do you want this job? It is an important question, but why do you want this job?
Let me say that Robert Kennedy said that we're judged by what we contribute to society. And, you know, I try to contribute to society through my practice. And I've been practicing for 32 years. And where I've tried to focus is on children. And the juvenile court is a court that you can do the most good. You can really make a difference. I feel energized to take on this position, if I'm confirmed. I want to try to help. As I said in my statement, I can think of no higher calling than helping children. Some of my best moments in practicing law were helping kids, getting through the system, you know, helping them move forward. And I feel I would be blessed to do that. Regardless of the position, I think this is the position you can do some good work.
I think that's a great answer. This is one of the courts, you know, all the courts are important. I feel the same way about this court. I think this is one of, if not the most important court, because you really have the chance to change the trajectory of someone's life at a critical moment for them. And it is a place to do great, great good. I'm only going to ask you a couple of questions. One of them is, and you probably know because I ask these questions all the time, what is your experience working with the gay, lesbian, transgender community?
I have had many clients who are gay, in juvenile, in probate. I do not believe I have had a transgender client, but I can tell you I've represented many gay people. I think back, this was a while ago, but this was in probate court. I think back on a client that I had, a great guy, fabulous guy, gay man, had a child with a woman, and he was treated so poorly in the court. He came to me subsequently. He had one son. And I was amazed at the dignity of him, at what he'd been through. But what we did was we wanted custody of the child, a boy of 12. And we went through a court case in Norfolk County. And I must say that the mother of the child wasn't a pleasant person. She wasn't a nice person. She would make comments about my client. I found those to be outrageous, and I made sure that the court knew what type of person they were dealing with. And I am pleased to say that my client got custody of that child. And as I think one of my speakers said, that, you know, I did keep in touch with him. Child did fabulously, and I'm so happy because I know that man was a great guy, great guy.
Well, one of my concerns is we have, you know, the country faces so many issues right now, and the kids are facing
Absolutely.
More than you and I, who are
Absolutely.
About the same age, could even imagine. But these children who are gay, lesbian, bi, transsexual, which is a very difficult thing for many folks to get their heads around. And I acknowledge that, but I also know that this is a real thing. And it can be problematic for the families of these children. Some families, you know, it's their child and they love them no matter what. Some families, for whatever reason, have a hard time with it. And it concerns me. There are so many things that come out of that. We have loads of kids living on the streets because they don't feel, in this population, they don't feel safe at home or in foster care. Or in shelters sometimes. We have epidemics of sexually transmitted diseases in pregnancy with young lesbians because they're working as sex workers. And it's really not okay. You know, as adults, as Americans, this is not a good thing. We've got to do better. And I feel that the judges who sit in this particular court really need to be very aware of this and understand, as almost every circumstance you're going to see in this court, these are extraordinary circumstances. I know the justice, the chief justices, I know they are working very hard at more education. I have every belief that you will take advantage of that education and work your hardest to, you know, as you've already stated, be as knowledgeable and compassionate as you can and still be fair.
Yes.
To me, that's a really important thing. You know, I tell people these are our children collectively, as adults, as Americans, these are our kids. Whether you get it or you don't get it, whether you understand it, what I've put my mother through, I mean, you know, honestly, she still loves me. And I've talked to Governor Baker about this when we talked about issues. You know, my mother is a 90-year-old Italian-Irish Catholic who worked for Richard Nixon. She gets it. And all she says is it's somebody's child. You love your children, you know? And she also said to me years ago, the most important thing she learned as a parent was the word acceptance. Because if you accept your children, you will have a relationship with them. And if you don't, you can make, not just, you think you might be like making their life tough, you're gonna make your own life miserable. So I say that's my sage,
absolutely,
Italian Republican mother. my last thing I'll say to you, and I say it to everyone who sits in that chair, particularly for this court, and you probably, I know you have a terrific family. I've heard wonderful things about your spouse. So you stepped out on the right foot right there.
I appreciate that.
You made a good choice. And that, you know, says a lot about your judgment. Think about how you will keep yourself fresh. Think about how you will restore yourself spiritually for this work. Because this is very hard work you are about to embark on. You will hear and you will see things, which I'm sure you already do, but as the judge, it is different, that are going to really be heavy and weigh on you. And so I think it's very important for our justices, who are so easy for the public to knock, you know, if something goes awry. It's real easy for everyone to pick power on them and say they're rotten and everything. But we have to recognize the work that you're doing and keeping, you know, being able to keep doing it and knowing when you have to step back from it. So do think about that. If you know, I tell people it can be any kind of a practice that you have, but I do think it's important, particularly in this court. I've heard fabulous things about you. Just great, great reviews all the way around. And like I said, for me, for this court, super important. So.
Thank you,
Counselor.
I appreciate
it's
that.
My pleasure. It's all. Thank you,
Chairman.
Counselor Kennedy.
I make no secret of the fact that we've known each other for better than 25 years. It's a pretty funny relationship. When you were in my office, you would call, my wife called, and I jokingly said, I'm kind of down with the emotion, I'm on the fence. And she said to me, you have to go for him. His wife is nice. So
I have to
get you to a higher authority on this one. I'm going to play next week.
Thank you.
We're great.
Appreciate that. Thank you.
Counselor Casey,
good afternoon. Good afternoon.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Good morning. I don't have a lot of questions. I do have some questions. Your choice in donations is to be desired. Hold that against you.
They're all friends.
Not hold that against you. I don't have a lot of questions. I do have a great resume. I love the private practice. I like the diversity. I've really seen it all. I'm not at all scared for being juvenile. I think I got it wrong. But I do have a couple questions.
Sure.
Why? I noticed in your materials, 35% probate for family. You can help kids in probate for family. So what was the draw?
Thank you for the question. I really grew up with the juvenile court, and as sometimes happens with practice, I began to get involved with family law. always harken back to the juvenile court. It was really a special court for me. I certainly did a lot with the probate court. I became a conciliator at the Middlesex Probate Court. I tried to resolve a number of cases. In fact, I just resolved a case, really a contested custody case that worked out. I was able to help in resolve the case. It's a different court, as I said. As you know, there are a lot of motions. There's a lot of back and forth. And the kids are the most important thing. And sometimes when you're dealing with these cases, sometimes the parents don't recognize that. And my feeling was that the juvenile court provided a vehicle to really help a child with no extraneous motivations going around them, a parent saying this or that. So I just felt that it was the court that I could do the most with. Itself in 1953 talks about protection of children. Does talk about reunification or family, but the overriding issue is the safety of the child and the child and the health of the child. So I'm a little bit less concerned about second chances of parents in that situation because we can always look to the facts of the case and determine second chance, or just maybe malingering and then trying to get more help and then not following through. So, if it involves the safety of the child, I would be hesitant. I certainly would not refuse second chances depending on the facts of the case. So, if there was a parent who's following the service plan, visiting with the child, involved in whatever treatment. Is necessary. There is some benefit to that, but if it's a situation where a child is or a parent isn't visiting a child, parent isn't following through with the service plan, that's something where I'm not really going to be generous. With regard to the delinquencies, I think that I've looked at Dan Conley's program in Suffolk County. It's just written up in the papers back today. Those are second chances with kids that really kids often do need second chances. I mean, it depends on the facts, depends on the particular conduct. But you can, a lot of times when you look behind the kid, what have they gone through? What has happened to them? You can judge whether there should be some sort of second chance. And that's something that you would weigh based on their past, their conduct, and how they are in court. But I think I would be more amenable to trying to give kids second chance versus an inherent protection of parents.
Yeah, I completely agree with your statements with respect to kids having a second chance. You know, growing up in such an age where, you know, the media is everywhere, the minute you do something, it's, you know, it's on the internet, or, you know, there's no, okay, I'll give you a ride home, or don't do that again, or you're in big trouble with your parents when you get home, you know, those types of things where kids can end up with records or in court. And, you know, people, I'm sure we, everybody in this room can think of somebody who did something stupid as a kid, now they've gone on to be a doctor or a professional,
sure,
or whatever, and if they had ever had a record, maybe they didn't get into medical school. I know it's a juvenile record, but
yes,
it can have a lot of consequences.
Absolutely.
So I think that's really important in the cases. And the flip side, other scenario where you talk about second chances for parents in care and custody cases where, you know, they're suffering from, I'm going to use addiction, that seems to be, I think, the epidemic in juvenile court. Wall Street Journal ran a story, and I'm going to say about 6 months ago, where the front page was a picture of grandparents raising their grandchildren, and that is just so prevalent now everywhere. It doesn't matter the state, it doesn't matter the socioeconomic, demographic area. And I think that I read that story, and listening to your comments, I think the kids have to. I've always said we have these hearings with respect to juvenile needs, that really shouldn't the legislature maybe take a look at reunification as the ultimate goal, put the child's safety first, because that's really what's important. Kids, I think, sometimes get lost in the conversation about drug addiction, and it's all about how do we get the parents better? And what do you do with this 4 or 9-year-old who it's not their fault, and seen their parents overdose 3 times and they're brought back to life? Just a daily occurrence. So I completely agree and applaud your answer with respect to the kids first. You know what? Parents get their act together, right? They don't, you know, you got to take care of the innocent child. So it's a good answer. And what types of, with respect to the, just to follow up on the second chances for good kids who make bad decisions or a bad decision and they find themselves in the juvenile court, what type of diversion program would you consider prior to giving a juvenile a record, things that they could do so they don't end up with a record?
There's a lot of community service programs. There's certainly a lot of the diversion can also be treatment, you know, whatever the issues are, following through with treatment. I think each, you know, Middlesex County, you know, the district attorney's office has a diversion plan, community service, things like that. And then the court also, Middlesex Juvenile Court as a diversion plan program to move kids out. I think, you know, a lot of the issues, what sometimes tends to happen is there's a lot of issues with regard to events at school, for example. There's a child who may be defiant and say something, and maybe he's, maybe acts out, and maybe he's arrested for disorderly conduct or something like that. That's an issue that really should not be in the court. I would suggest that that would be something that maybe that child is required for help. At that point, that would be a person who should be placed in some sort of diversion program to avoid, as you said, the juvenile record, which can follow you. Even though it's a juvenile record, it's still available to police and courts and affects a lot of things in life. So I think diversion programs are important for certainly nonviolence, sometimes issues regarding activities in the home or school.
Are there any that you've thought of that you'd like to see implemented that you don't see in courts now?
You know, I can't think of anything at this time. I think a lot of times it's community service, and a lot of times it's, you know, I've had cases with Ted Potter, was first assistant clerk at Middlesex Juvenile Court. You know, he would try to work with the children, and perhaps there would be reports written about certain, you know, issues and letters sent to various people with issues with conduct. I can certainly look at other things, and I think what one has to be in that job is creative. So if someone was, something was brought to me that I thought would work, I would certainly be willing to try.
And I know that Vassar, as a guardian in life on certain cases, you said that in your capacity at the GAL, you've been a GAL on issues of waiver.
Yes.
Waiving child's privilege.
Yes.
And let me ask you this, what has been, I have served as a GAL, I've been in probate court for a number of years, but I've never served in the capacity on the issue, the sole issue of child's privilege. What is your approach? I'm just curious. Mindset as to whether or not at the end of the day everything's on par,
yep.
You jump off, you need to ask the kid, what are your thoughts about, you know, people about this? I mean, how do you end up reaching your ultimate decision on whether or not to be a child's privilege, which
yep.
I think is a really big deal?
It is a big deal. What I've done many. So I usually, you know, I don't wear a suit. I go out, I always visit the child. I try to get a rapport. And obviously, it's a child who's usually in custody battle. There's issues with the parents are fighting, or there's an allegation of such and such. The child is treated with the mental health professional. I do, and you know, it depends on the age. I mean, you can, in that situation, usually the children are old enough when they are in therapy that you can talk to them in general terms. Because that is one of the criteria. What do they want? What would, you know, you do have to weigh their position. My experience has been that most kids will say, I want the therapist to testify or report to be produced. You know, you can try to work around other ways of having it confidential. Maybe there's ability to have the evidence put out in a different manner through other opportunities, but in general, I do ask them, and it is really it's a rewarding position because you know I have been in jail in other ways, but it's an opportunity to really sit with the child and get a sense because they're not going to talk in court, obviously, but their therapist is their if there are issues, the therapist is their voice a lot of times. I think I would say the overwhelming majority, they do want to have the records produced, and I do ask them specifically if that is the case. That is one of the criteria.
And I noticed that in your information, you've had primarily non-jury trials,
correct.
99%. Jury and non-jury. You can have jury trials in juvenile court. What, if anything, have you done to prepare for that?
Well, I'm never good at those percentages. I probably had, I mean, I've had well over 100.
You're an attorney, right? We divide by three.
Trials, yeah, exactly. good point. That's one thing I do know, the numbers in the third of every number, but I probably had 10 to 15 jury trials. So I've had jury trials in, you know, way back when. I mean, I was a bar advocate for 10 years or so, and I practiced delinquency law. But I certainly read the law. I study the law. I read the new cases. I involve myself with that. So I think I am prepared for a jury trial. I've had them, and I know that certainly cases change and procedures change. But I think I would be able to handle that as a judge.
So now you're practicing for 31 years, probably garnished the requisite experience and knowledge of 31 years of practice. And, I know in question 75, you referred to this counter to one of the qualifications or qualities that temperament, integrity, hard work, and empathy. And my question is, who does the empathy encompass? of all the players who you think should enjoy DMV and the judge meetings?
Well, certainly the child. The juvenile court, I think, as I said, the focus is on the child. And I think the point is to you know, you. I think, thankfully, most of us have been blessed with good childhoods. We've been raised in loving families. I certainly have been. My son has been. But a lot of people haven't. And I think understanding where people come from, and certainly a kid can act out whatever happens. But, you know, you really have to understand where they've been and what they've been through. You know, I read a lot of juvenile case law, and you hear about these kids, what all they've gone through. And I've had them in cases, but, you know, Supreme Court cases that have made new law, and you look behind it, so you see what they've lived through. And I don't know if I could have succeeded. I've had cases where kids have been horribly abused, and they've gone through it, and they've turned out well, they've been successful. That's one of the cases I mentioned in the application. So certainly the empathy for the child in the juvenile court. Certainly with parents, we do have to understand where the parent is. And I would recognize that. I think, though, that ultimately it's really focused on the child.
Are you familiar with the Chardon case?
I am.
Zinchenko?
Yes.
Have you heard some of my questions with respect to what I view as an inconsistent holding by the SJC with respect to the juvenile brain? Well, started with the United States Supreme Court.
Roper,
and
Miller versus Alabama.
Okay. So Miller, thank you. And then that, you know, after that holding, we had our holding in the state of Chenko, we're now bringing on Bella for purposes of
exactly.
And then we had a Chardon case which predated Chenko, where the holding was that, you know, he has a juvenile record.
It was.
And so fast forward, it was adjudicated delinquent. Fast forward, I don't know, 20 plus years later, he's a good citizen, he's a taxpayer, he's a father, he's a husband, he's a homeowner, he's a working guy.
Excuse me, I've asked everyone to put their cell phones away. I respect the process.
No problems.
Please put your cell phones away.
After, that initial juvenile interaction with the law, and yet the SJC said that was disqualified for MPC, and I just struggled with that because either the brain is developed for purposes of, opportunity for parole in cases of murder, okay, or either it is or it isn't, and it's either developed or not for purposes of somebody exercising the constitutional right to obtain a firearm. I just always struggled with those two.
It's interesting. I mean, the Chardon case is from 2013. The Chardon case, the SJC did kind of try to come up with a rationality for what they were saying. I guess ultimately their claim was that license to carry was not liberty, it was more of a privilege, I guess, that they couldn't hold that. I did question that. I mean, if the research is what it is, and I've read the research, and it is, I mean, with brain imaging and social science, it does seem to be that is the case, that the juvenile brain is not developed. We don't let kids under 18 vote, or we restrict their license, we don't let them marry, et cetera, et cetera. So I think you're right. I think there is kind of there's a break in logic. I guess they came down to say that we're not really doing, we're not taking away liberty, we're more not giving him a license. So
yeah, but it's the same thing. So the second versus the eighth, it's cruel and unusual violation of the Eighth Amendment in Chenko. Yeah, it's not really a Second Amendment. It's some other privilege. And it's like Catan style.
Yeah.
That was an embarrassing decision by the U.S. Our SPC said that a woman couldn't have a stun gun, which is a non-lethal glad that you read those. It's an interesting question.
Jim Rose.
If anybody has the money, I guess they can make up the decision. Again, if they have some back down. But, just a couple last points. I'm a big fan of Council Kennedy. I really respect what he says. He's a practicing lawyer. He's a very good lawyer. He jokes about the kind of lawyer he is.
Very, very good.
He's a good colleague on his council. We reached out to him. And Attorney Donald Paul, who's a retired police officer and a practicing lawyer in this town, he approached me at a ceremony for now Judge Paul Suschek. And literally fought his way through. It was a packed room. And I'm like, oh no, what is going on? He must want a continuance. We have a case on him. Relay his sentiments about your qualifications and how he felt about you, and that you were really a superb pick. I want to point that out. And just lastly, I know you mentioned you quoted Robert Kennedy.
Absolutely.
And, what a lot of people don't know is that he was quoted as saying that he never ran for governor because everybody knew that really the governor's council wins. I never knew he said that. My partner, Mike Caplet, in my office, he pointed that out to me one day. You know, we read about the council all the time. It's not always flattering in the newspaper,
yep.
And I think we get a bad rub. And then there was a recent article in Lawyers Weekly that just completely failed to fact check anything, suggesting our hearing more reports and some other stuff. And, smart man, Mark.
Pictures in my office.
Okay, yeah. Well, I think you're a superb nominee, as Attorney Ball said. I congratulate you.
Thank you.
I like your answer. I think you've got a great judicial philosophy and obviously. So
thank you.
I wish you well.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Before I call on Councilor Clay, I just want to pick up on Council's comment about some of the things that are said, and you have some of the lawyers we could hear. So I'm not going to address anything except to say, we do have a record. We do record all of our hearings, and I welcome anyone from the Lawyers Week to come to our office, and you can hear it.
And publish
anything else.
Publish.
Okay.
And all the hearings are published.
Excuse me. I called on Councilor.
I would just add that they are published. We post all our meetings. They're all open to the public. Anybody can testify. You can testify if you want. You raise your hand. And the irony is, we are the only open process, public process, if you will, once a person applies for a judge. We were the only transparent, open meeting, public, come and testify, part of the entire process. And if somebody had contacted any of us from Lawyers Weekly, we would have gladly pointed that out. So, in fact, sometimes our hearings are so open, we have to have them outside of this chamber. In the Senate Room 222 and in the Garner Auditorium, which we did for Chief Justice Gans's 3-day judicial confirmation of Chief Justice. So, we are the only public part of the process, so I kind of chuckled when I read that article and just want to point that out. So, but thank you very much for your testimony.
Thank you.
I wanted to bring that up only because we do have one here. I wouldn't have brought it up. But I'm very proud that I established the first public website. We never had a website for the Governor's Council, and I established that 18 years ago. So you can look at that and you can see what our duties are, what our districts are. I have my cell phone number for people to call me, and it tells who has been appointed by the Governor and when the Governor's Council is going to hold that public hearing. So I wasn't going to get on my soapbox on this, but when you brought it up, and we have a member here of Lawyers Weekly, I just think it's, it's easy to say things, but it really is egregious when they're not true. And I'm very proud of the process, and I welcome anyone to hear the recording of this hearing.
So,
Councilor Kennedy.
The issue with Lawyers Weekly has nothing to do with this nominee, we'll get back on track in one second, was, first of all, I recognize the editorial board is different than the reporter that's sitting here. We have nothing to do with each other. When they wrote that editorial, it's in this week's Lawyers Weekly, suggesting that we weren't trying. suggestions as to what they simply have their facts wrong. Because a lot of things that they said we don't do, we do in fact do. We publish our hearings ahead of time. They're on the website. They're published.
Newspaper.
They're in the newspaper. We record them. We have an official recording. They suggested we didn't. And frankly, anybody on that board of editors could have picked up the phone and verified their facts. They just blocked them wrong, period. And you know that's just too bad because it is a prestigious editorial board. They have an important function, and it's disappointing that they didn't check the facts before they were completely inaccurate.
And to add to that, we vote roll call, you know, have that in other boards. And we are the only checks and balances for the governor, only elected body. So I didn't mean to get on this, but it's
well, I would also just say very briefly on that point, the entire process, and this, you know, the JNC does a good job, the Joint Party does a good job. We are the only body in the entire process whose comments are recorded, we're on the record, what we say and what we do, and whose votes are a matter of public record. We have two entities can't say that
as well.
In the public comments.
So it's all on the record. Okay, I think we can all get on our soapbox.
I think you wrote enough. He's got a lot of notes there. He's ready.
Excuse me, Councilor Hurley. Thank you for your patience.
Thank you.
We met new times.
Yes.
And so we just ask the question. Do you mind this a little
bit? Song, he's a court magistrate.
So
he
likes you a lot.
I like to go to his parties.
Oh, there you go. In all seriousness, questions were asked by Council Greenville concerning one judge who I don't have to vote for. There's not going to be any account of that. And when you're a judge, you also are all over your cases, and your case flow management issues are monitored by the Chief Justice of your court. And I feel very fond of the Justice of the Ladies, Justice of the Nine. Someone comes to court for a trial or for a hearing in juvenile court without a judge, without a jury. They're there to get answers where the rest of their life is going. And so if you have someone who consistently pays cases, it is not. There's a way to do it. It's a lot nicer than stamping something, whatever. And there has to be a balance. But also, too, you have to understand that you have an obligation as a judge to keep those cases moving in accordance with the rules. If you don't have rules, you have chaos. And so, one of the things that I think I like about what you had to say was, law and the focus has been on parental rights. And I think I agree wholeheartedly with several counselors, and that is that we have to start focusing on what's in the best interest of the child or children. And when you have a chance, we have to judge. Just like what you have to say on that whole
I think it is intertwined with drug addiction and mental health. I think, you know, drug addiction is caused over 40% rise in parent protection cases. What to do about it is multifaceted. Education, treatment, getting to the kids early. One thing that I would like to do if I was so committed is, if I'm in firm, is go to the schools and talk. And I think maybe that might help. Whatever can help, I would try to do. But it is a treatment issue, I think. That's what really, I think, between at least younger adults, 18 to 24, opioid addiction is killing people. That's the 25% death rate of that age. So it is really a multifaceted approach to address that. I know the governor is trying to address it. I think there needs to be more substance abuse treatment centers. Obviously, the parents have to weigh in as well. There are parents in the home who assist in that.
All right, and the other issue that we talked briefly about juvenile records.
Yes.
And the fact that they're sealed, but they can impact someone as an adult. What I put across my mind is those cases where somebody's charged with statutory rape, 15 or 16 year old, involved in 15 or 16 year old. And that early on, you know, a lawyer would say, okay, it's sealed, nobody's ever going to see it. You know, they're talking about giving you probation. And then all of a sudden, the whole requirements for registration, sex offender registry, the whole nine yards comes up, and all of a sudden, that's all public. So, another area that I would like to make you aware of from my years was that you have somebody who, as a juvenile, somebody brings a restraining order or harassment. And you got to think twice because those are going to appear on their record forever. And can have impact. So what would your philosophy be here?
With regard to the first point, the statutory rape issue, there is a matter or manner that what can avoid any type of appearance on the record. In the Roberto H. case, that if there isn't probable cause, the motion brought pre-arraignment to avoid that. With regard to the sex registration, the court under 178 did not require a juvenile to register. So there are some manners with regard to sex registration or statutory rape that you mentioned. The idea of the issues with regard to the record, as Council Casey mentioned, for example, the gun issue, that is a problem. You see that in PSJ's informal. But I do recognize regarding the restraining order, I have defended many people in 498 cases, and I recognize the seriousness of that. And it really does require a real weighing of the facts and fact finding to make sure of the credibility, et cetera. That would not be something that I would just nonchalantly report. I was.
You're aware that you have to do the judicial response several times a year.
Absolutely.
So that on the weekend, somebody can say, years ago, that's what happened. Is that reason you should use the if it was as you're saying.